Good morning and welcome back to Morning Express. We are glad you're watching on this Tuesday. It is the 12th day of May 2015. My name is Sophia Wanuna. We still have lots in store for you in the next hour. On our Your Health segment, Michael Gitonga will be tackling cholera. A number of lives have been lost in the past few days. Some counties still grappling with this disease. So do stay with us for that in the next hour. It's coming up. But it is now time for Person of Interest. Today we are hosting the Cabinet Secretary, East African Affairs, Commerce and Tourism. Key sectors in this country, very important for economy and engagement with our neighbors as well. So we'll be canvassing quite a number of issues. And if you have a question for the CS, tweet it in at Sophia Wanuna. You can SMS 22155 and we'll put your questions to her this morning. Cabinet Secretary, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Let's begin with tourism. But before we go there, my director reminds me that before we get to very important issues, we'd like to know a little bit about our guests. And many got to know you during the grilling when you were appointed Cabinet Secretary of Tourism. There was a grilling session. They're like, okay, this is Phyllis Kandie. But very few got to know where is she from, what's her background, where did she work before, where did she go to school. Briefly tell us about you.
Thank you so much. My background is I'm an investment banker.
Okay.
So I know so much about the capital markets in general. But before that, I was a regulator. Mm-hmm. I have done regulation in the capital markets since I was in CMA. I was also a regulator at ERB, that is the petroleum sector. Mm-hmm. I was a board member at KRA, board member at HCDA. So generally, you know, in the agricultural sector and in the financial sector.
Yeah.
But before that, I did my degree in BCom in Canada, and then I did my MBA in UK. Basically, I'm a finance background person.
Person.
Yes.
Okay. So growing up, the younger Phyllis, what did she want to do to become?
I've always been interested in business.
Okay.
So if you see, my courses has always leaned towards business courses. Mm-hmm. Because I did BCom and I did an MBA in finance. And so that has been my background. Finance, you know, always about money, counting money. Even if I was in the stock exchange, you know, regulating the stock exchange in CMA.
Yeah.
So my background is really around finance and business.
Okay.
Yes.
So the president came and said, we want you to head this docket. Did you feel you were up to the task? Were you like, okay, a little bit jittery? What was that moment like for you?
I think, you know, taking a big step, like, you know, being in charge of a public office is not easy for everybody.
Right.
And I think it's something that everybody really feels it's an honor to do. And so coming from the private sector, and if I put it, yeah. You know, private sector people are private. They do their thing. And so yes, I could have been jittery initially, but I think, you know, I learned quickly in the mm-hmm. job. And I think I got the team together and we're working very well.
Yeah, and we'll get to the matters at hand and what your work day to day is, but it's a huge docket you have dealing with East African affairs. You have tourism in itself, huge income and a foreign exchange and for Kenya. So how do you get time for you and your family and to just be Phyllis, downtime?
It boils down to discipline.
Does it? Okay.
Yes, it does. I have to have my me time with the family, mm-hmm. My me time with going to church, you know, my me time with, you know, ensuring that I take care of my body, exercise and so forth. So
okay.
Also I'm very compartmental in the way I do things.
So Phyllis is married?
Yes.
Kids?
I have two boys.
Oh, that's nice.
Yes.
How old are they?
Oh, they're big boys.
Yeah.
I have a 21-year-old at Leeds mm-hmm. right now doing his law. Mm-hmm. And I have a 24-year-old who's just finished commercial piloting.
Okay.
So I have big boys.
Exciting
yes.
stuff.
Yes.
And so for working out, what, every day, once a week?
Yes. Twice? I'm very disciplined with the gym. And I do at least 3 or 4 times a week in the morning.
Yeah.
That's my me time.
Yes.
You know, and that gives me the energy to really manage what I have to do during the day. It's almost that I'm almost hooked to that. I have to do it. Yeah. Otherwise,
sounds
I can't
like
function. Yes, I can't function.
Yeah.
So I do that regularly as much as I can. Of course, I travel a lot, so I try to do it wherever I go.
Yeah.
That I have to do. I play golf once in a while, but I don't really have the time for it.
Yeah.
So I'm very poor at it right now.
Okay.
But
I was going to ask, they ask about handicap, what handicap are you? But I'm so clueless about it, I'm not even going to pretend to ask.
Yeah.
But so once in a while, some golf.
Once in a while, some golf.
Okay.
Mainly, really, I'm a gym person.
You're a gym person.
Yes.
All right. Well, it's good to get to know that side of you, because we never, interviews are so tourism, numbers, this and the other. So it's good to get to know that side of you, and we thank you for sharing. Let's talk tourism now. And of course, the country has suffered a number of terrorist attacks. Locally, there have also been insecurity issues. And that has affected tourism in a significant way, because then many hear all of these stories, see all of these things, and like, I want to stay away from Kenya. Talk to us about the impact of terror on tourism in the past 2 years, let's say.
You know, if I recall very well, 2 months after the Jubilee administration took over, the numbers really shot up.
Okay.
And we were quite excited at the ministry to see the numbers going up. And unfortunately, we had the Westgate incident, and really that now started, you know, affecting the sector. As you know, tourism is very sensitive.
Yes.
It's about people really visiting a country, and they quickly change their minds as to whether they really would like to go there, and they come here for leisure to see the country. And so overall, I think the tourism sector, we all agree, has been affected by these security challenges that we're having. We looked at the numbers. It has dropped by 30% as compared to last year.
Okay.
Yes, at the coast, we have been affected very in terms of hotels closing. We have lost at least on average about 20,000 jobs. But you know, in other parts of the country, you know, the numbers are encouraging.
Okay.
In fact, last year we were still voted the best safari destination, in spite of. And so that tells us we have a beautiful product, you know, and that stands. Kenya is still the best destination in terms of tourism. And so while this has happened and we're facing those challenges as government, we're dealing with the issue of the security challenges that we are facing. I think bottom line, the problem is really the negative perceptions, the negative stories getting out of here. That is the big challenge for us.
Okay.
And that's something we need to tackle head on.
Oh. Both
as a ministry, as even as citizens of this country, as you know, the private sector of this country, because we while we have an incident, and I'm not saying it's a big problem, it is, in one part of the country, largely the rest of the country is safe.
Is safe.
And that's what is misunderstood out there.
And let's talk about that perception, because there are reports indicating, I think it was one of the stakeholders in the industry that were accusing even the media of just the stories that we run. Do you also get a sense that the media has not helped, say, your efforts, supported in as far as painting the country, saying this and this is happening? Because on one hand, the media reports what's happening. On the other, it has implications, because somebody watching, going on the net and watching KTN story on this and the other says this is a country that's not safe.
I think it's all of us. Like I've just said, you know, now the social media is huge.
Okay.
And even the story, just somebody tweeting something negative, you know, it's just enough to make a lot of damage to this country.
Right.
So I think the responsibility is for all of us, you know, from government, from private sector, citizens, the media, all of us have to help this country, or rather we have to really try to help us as Kenya to give the right stories out there.
Okay.
Yes.
And then there's the question of the travel advisories. That in itself has been significant, in as far as quite a number of them have been standing, they're revised time and again. And recently we've had the EU boss, we've had the British foreign minister again come out and say the reason we're not revising these travel advisories downwards is because we're not getting sufficient information from Kenya, the state, on how what they're doing to work on security. And I know you're not in charge of security, but how is it as the ministry in charge of tourism, because you're hugely impacted by these advisories, are you engaging with the interior ministry, are you engaging with foreign affairs and the government to ensure that if this is the issue, that then they're furnished with the information they need to revise these advisories?
I think before I answer this, let me just put this, let me say this, that travel advisories has been, you know, from time to time we get these travel advisories, you know, but also they are lifted as and when, you know.
Right.
So this is not, it's something not new.
Okay.
What I think is the main challenge, and I think is because of this new problem that we, you know, is a global issue, this terrorism. And it's taken so long before it is lifted, and I think that is where the big challenge is. And so yes, we are dealing with a new challenge, and we exchange information between ministries. I talk to my colleagues, you know, internal security seers all the time, and I say, you know, we exchange information, mm-hmm. we engage, you know, with the diplomatic community together. We work with CS Foreign Affairs, so we work together as cabinet colleagues, you know, to try to reassure, because it's about reassurance, it's about what we are doing, you know, as government, to deal with the issues.
So when they come out and say they're not getting this information, the president in an interview a few weeks ago said it's not true. They're furnishing, as Kenyan government is furnishing these countries with information, so saying they're being dishonest with that kind of a narrative. Do you agree with the same? Do you think you have done best you can yourself and colleagues, and that there are other reasons that are pushing them to revise these advisories upwards?
Well, I don't want to prod too much into the details of security matters. Mm-hmm. As you know, I'm not in
yes.
charge of security.
Right.
But as far as I know, and as far as what my colleagues tell me, they exchange the information with
okay.
our partners. As I've just said, the issue is international in nature.
Mm.
It's not really a Kenyan issue. And so, you know, there's that, you know, exchange of information. So I can't really prod into the details of it, but,
okay.
you know, really those engagements are continuous. Yes.
Help us understand, for those who don't, when there's a travel advisory, say, given by the British, by the US, by Australia, whichever country, this is to tell their citizens this and these areas are unsafe. But what are those other issues that make it very then difficult for those nationals to be able to visit the country? The question of insurance, perhaps. What can you help us understand in how significant these travel advisories are and impacting on tourism?
As far as I know, for UK in particular,
okay.
the issue of insurance cover is major. And we've tried to come up with, you know, local products to see how we can help them to travel and have insurance cover. You know, I know a few private sector, you know, insurance companies that have done that
mm-hmm.
locally, and but it has not gained any traction in UK. That has been the challenge for us. So insurance is huge for the UK market in particular, but. We still get a lot of tourists coming from German market, for example, the US market, the Italian market, for example.
Mm-hmm.
So I think largely it really depends on the market, the source market itself. And so while I think a lot of people, from what I got from the US, they do a lot of research before they travel to any country.
Okay.
For those who are repeat tourists, you know, they
come
Kenya
often.
Is one destination that you get a lot of repeat tourists coming back. They know the country very well,
right.
and they do come. And so, you know, the issue of insurance is very specific to certain markets. Some markets are more resilient than others. Mm-hmm. And the largely, you know, most tourists do a lot of research. And I think that is why we need to go back. When they research in the social media, they see all these negative stories coming, you know. From Kenya, for example.
Kenya.
And so that's what I'm saying. I mean, we all have to try, really, and give out and support government's efforts in terms of, and the private sector. Mm. There is really, really suffering, and I feel for the private sector.
Okay.
To try to get out positive stories. Mm. And that's why, as a ministry, we've engaged an international PR firm to help us in this. If you've been looking, seeing in the last
British
2 weeks,
firm?
Yes, yeah. It is. You know, we've been trying to churn out positive stories going out there.
Okay, and we'll talk about in terms of what you're doing in selling Kenya. But let's come back to what you're doing as a ministry to cushion the industry, because you've mentioned about 20,000 jobs have been lost, hotels are being shut down at the coast, the industry continues to suffer. What is it you're doing? Because other countries have either subsidies, they'll put in place measures to always ensure that at the end of the day, in this bad space or tough period of time, they can still emerge and continue. But this appears to be killing the industry. Will Kenya survive? Will Kenya come out of this? And what are you doing to ensure that happens?
If you recall, last year we did put up quite a number of incentives to support the sector. Mm-hmm. And largely most of them have worked. And so that is one way of, you know, supporting the private sector.
Which ones have worked?
You remember that there was a policy that, you know, for example, that, you know, conferences would only be held in government hotels. Mm-hmm. That was reversed, and now it's actually even private sector hotels can hold those government conferences.
Okay.
So that one has really worked, and it has really helped, especially hotels that are focusing on domestic tourism. That has really, really helped. There was also a number of measures that did not work, for example. I think we need to accept this. But for example, there was one policy where, you know, we expected the private sector to have a tax rebate. I think that has worked also. But then there was also, we were supposed to, you know, give them support in terms of, you know, developing an e-portal mm-hmm. for the private sector.
Right.
I think this likely was supposed to be a private sector, led process.
Right.
In as far as that is concerned, so that has not picked up. And I think, you know, we're encouraging the private sector to take on that initiative.
Mm-hmm.
And so, based on that, I think we also did reduce the park fees, comparing that on a comparative basis with our neighbors. I think that was received very well. There's still calls for us to reduce the park fees, and we're looking at that. As government, but you know, at the end of the day, we need to balance between, you know, ensuring that we support the Minister of Environment in terms of, you know, anti-poaching initiatives and so forth, because again, we have to look after the parks. So if we reduce, you know, the park fees to a level where,
but are you saying higher fees is what will prevent poaching?
You know, at the end of the day, we will all be looking at the exchequer at the end of the day. So I think we're still trying to do a balancing act.
Okay.
To see how low can we go. To the level where we still support KWS with their work in terms of safeguarding or taking care of mm-hmm. the parks the way they should be doing.
Yes. And there's a package on corporates allowing their employees to take holidays tax exempt. That did not appear to work. Why? Was it not fully thought out at the beginning?
I think, as you know, I mean, as government, we developed the policy together with the private sector. I think that's something that was discussed, and you know, we thought it would work. We had all the good intentions as government to, that it would work. But for some reason, it didn't receive any traction from private sector. And perhaps, you know, on hindsight, I think we, you know, we looked at it and we said, maybe it's something that needs a bit more discussion. Mm. And I think those discussions are still going on between us, Treasury, and the private sector. So that's one of the other one that, yes, it didn't work. Yes.
So you now have commissioned this British firm. One would outrightly ask, they don't perhaps know or understand Kenya as best as perhaps a Kenyan firm would, and that it would be better if you gave the work to a Kenyan organization. What informed going outside to sell Kenya? You would imagine Kenya would best sell itself on the bare minimum, at the face of it, looking at it as is.
I think let me start by saying that this was an international bidding exercise. It's really the best firm that put the best proposal to the team that was selecting. Okay. That was selected at the end of the day. So I think that was the bottom line. As all government,
so it was open to Kenyans?
It was open to Kenyans. It was open to everyone. However, they're working with, they will work with local agencies to ensure that, that uncle in terms of really trying to understand how local
what you're selling.
Issues are dealt with. Because, you know, one of the things that they will be doing is to support us or help us in terms of rebranding. Now, when it comes to branding, first of all, it starts with the citizens itself. Mm-hmm. Unless we all understand, we are part of the branding process.
Correct.
What I referred to earlier in terms of even just our engagements in the social media, is part of our rebranding. What people pick up in the international community about Kenya comes from, you know, what they see.
Yeah. So granted, there is that role by every Kenyan, no matter where they
exactly.
are. But your ministry, in as far as Brand Kenya is concerned, that has not appeared to work very well. We've seen slogans like Tembea Kenya, which, yeah, once in a while have trended here and there. But in terms of that impact to bring in the numbers to paint Kenya as the destination, South Africa has done very well, I think, with their branding of the country and just getting everybody to imagine that's the best place in the world to visit. What is the challenge with selling Kenya, would you say?
I think the biggest challenge with selling Kenya is too many voices. We are trying to focus now on one voice, and you'll be seeing that. Again, we need to rally everybody towards that cause, because it's huge, it's major for us. Mm-hmm. So that's the kind of engagement
too
that's
many voices
going on
from
right
where?
Now. Too many voices from, you know, many people creating their own narratives, for example.
Yeah.
And so we need to agree on who we are as a country. Mm. How do we want the rest of the world to view us?
Do we know who we are? Have we defined that?
I think those are the kind of conversations that we should carry out as people.
Okay.
How do we want the rest of the world to view us? Who are we? Where do we want to take this country going forward? And how important is Kenya to you and me? Mm. You know, how do we put Kenya ahead of all of us?
And yet Kenyans expect you as a ministry in charge to spearhead those conversations, but we're not seeing you engaging
us.
We are
actually in the process of that engagement, and you'll be seeing that engagement. And I think, that's at least a tip to tell you that, yes, we're starting that process.
We're starting. All right.
Yes.
We will get back to more matters tourism. I know there are some of the questions that are coming in on Twitter, but let's talk a little bit about, which is partly linked to tourism, but also East African affairs, the tiff between Kenya and Tanzania. We saw it play out so badly that even the number of flights to Tanzania were slashed, and, you know, Kenya said you cannot now come to our airport, to our parks. And I understand there was an agreement, 1977.
85.
85. now we are back to status quo, but is, as an East African community and this kind of partnership relationship we should be having, should status quo be what remains at the end of the day, or can we do better?
No, if you recall, when we did announce the status quo, we said that His Excellency the President Uhuru Kenyatta and His Excellency President Kikwete did have a bilateral, you know, when they met in Angola.
Correct.
And they gave a directive to the ministers from both countries. Mm-hmm. That will be led by the ministers of foreign affairs from both countries. For us to sit down and really discuss these issues, our bilateral issues, one of which will be tourism, mm-hmm. You know, cross-border issues, one of which will be transport. And then there are quite a number of non-tariff barriers that we continuously engage, even mm-hmm. with our neighbor Uganda, with all our neighbors.
Yeah.
Those trade issues are always emerge, and we meet and we discuss them, and so that's why there was there was a directive for status quo, so that we can sit down and have this conversation, have this discussion with our neighbors. So mm-hmm. I want to believe, and since we're in the process of doing that, we are meeting as the Kenyan team to see how we can engage our neighbors.
Right.
And as East Africans, I think at the end of the day, we want to agree. And you've heard His Excellency the President say all the time, we're not competitors.
Yeah, you know? And they appear to be very suspicious of Kenyans, Tanzanians. Why is it they want to keep us as far as possible, going to take their jobs, coming to take over? What do you read into these suspicions or the mistrust that we see?
No, as neighbors, just like, brothers and sisters within one house, you'll always have, one... disagreements here and there as brothers and sisters. So I don't want to believe that it's something that we should all worry about. Mm-hmm. It's very normal, and we will disagree on others. We agree on others, but we are neighbors. We are East Africans, and we'll move on.
We'll move on, and
yes.
We'll get back to Tanzania later, because they have, in some cases, been reports that they feel isolated when it comes to this East African community. But Burundi first, because attention is on Burundi now. Nkurunziza insisting to go for a third term. The international community criticizing the same, saying it's unacceptable. Raila Odinga the other day criticized the EAC members for not doing enough to intervene, to come in and help with this member of East African community. So as your ministry is involved with EAC, what is it you're doing in conjunction, of course, with foreign affairs and other stakeholders to help?
Let me say this. We had our Council of Ministers meeting just mm-hmm. over a week and a half ago. We issued a statement as a Council of Ministers. Since then, I think, CS Amina Mohamed has met with the other foreign ministers in Burundi. And in fact, as I finish this, we are heading to Dar es Salaam for a meeting on Burundi. So there's a lot going on. Mm-hmm. Again, these are our neighbors, these are East African community member, and we will continue to sit down and reason together. So
yeah.
those efforts are going on. It's not that we haven't done anything as mm-hmm. government, we have.
Was there
that the chair is Tanzania.
Yeah.
So that's why we're going to Dar es Salaam.
Yeah, because this response, these meetings appearing to be coming late in the day, we're already seeing lives being lost. I mean, media houses are being shut down. Is the response a little bit too slow in coming to help intervene, seek solutions on the way forward?
I think Burundi is a sovereign state, as Tanas, they've tried to resolve the issues and themselves, but also, we as I've said, there've been engagements at my level mm-hmm. as minister, and I want to believe at the level of His Excellency the President. So we have been talking to them, or since this problem started.
But your thoughts on Nkurunziza seeking another term?
I think that we leave that to the people of Burundi at the end of the day. But we'll continue to encourage them. We'll continue to encourage them to, you know, agree on a way forward. And that's why we're going to Dar es Salaam today and tomorrow under the chairmanship of His Excellency President Kikwete to see how we can support them.
We can support. So we'll definitely be following and watching. But back to Tanzania. So EAC has Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, Burundi, Rwanda. Kenya, Uganda, and Rwanda have appeared to be very well reading from the same script as far as EAC is concerned. Burundi, again, Tanzania have seemingly been isolated. And in the past, we've talked, we've heard of sentiments or tags like the coalition of the willing. Where is EAC standing? Is it falling apart? Because it has fallen apart before. Is it holding now? Or are we seeing the three isolating the two? What are the issues?
I think let me first start by saying that a lot of progress has been achieved in as far as EAC is concerned. You know, we've really implemented a lot of policies, let alone just signing those protocols. We have made a lot of progress the past, you know, 15 months, for example. We have one area network. We have, you know, we use now in the three countries we use one, you know, your ID to cross
the borders. So one area network applies to all five?
One area network now applies to three countries,
which is
Kenya, Uganda, and Rwanda. Yes.
So why is it we don't have the other two yet?
You know, I think we need to really understand and accept, you know, some of the protocols, the policies within the ESC protocols that, you know, any two or three countries can move and implement certain protocols, and the rest will follow. I think, let me put the record straight. Remember, there is the Northern Corridor infrastructure meetings that are going on. I think that's what you're referring to. And just last, about 4 months ago, we went to Dar es Salaam to actually join, be part of a meeting that was discussing the Central Corridor. So those two initiatives are going on, and it's because that Kenya is, you know, spearheading the Northern Corridor talks does not mean that we've isolated Tanzania, which is spearheading the Central Corridor talks. Because really, infrastructure for East Africa is huge. If we don't develop our infrastructure, and the more the merrier, because we need, you know, we're starting from very far as far as, you know, not only East Africa is concerned, it's Africa. We really need to develop our infrastructure, because that will help us in terms of, you know, spearheading or development in those countries. So for us, you know, the development of the Northern Corridor and the Central Corridor is something that is has been decided at the summit level, and they're being spearheaded by Kenya and Tanzania respectively. So it doesn't mean that it's only that perhaps Tanzania started after we had, you know, had discussions on the Northern Corridor. But at the end of the day, there's a general understanding that is how it's
Which been. Then again raises questions, what kind of engagements take place, if any, before some of these projects, protocols are signed, projects are initiated? Because when you get on and you have three members, two are out, and then we're coming to talk about when they're ready, why not wait for everybody to be ready before then setting off as one solid entity, instead of having this, you know, this side and the other?
You know, at the end of the day, you've got to respect the decisions of each country. It's as and when they're ready, depending on, for example, you know, their budgetary implications, depending on, for example, in Kenya, I mean, the whole of East Africa regions, we have elections at different times. So depending on which administration comes in and decides these are the priority areas that they want to focus on, then obviously they'll push their agenda. And I think that is the case in Kenya.
Okay.
The Jubilee government came in, identified the Northern Corridor as a major, policy or priority area, and we pushed that agenda. Mm. So there are many things that you need to consider in terms of decision making.
Yes. Okay. And when we look at the national identity cards are being used. So these are being used across which countries to gain entry at the border points?
Again, on the ID cards, it's being used within the three countries, mm-hmm. Kenya, Uganda, and Rwanda.
And also the visa.
The East African visa, yes. It's again, it's, you know, because it's being used within the three countries.
Within the three countries. Yes. So that is working.
That is working.
That is going well.
Yes.
What about these questions and concerns people have had over flights? That you'll find a flight to an East African country will be so much more expensive than a flight further down. Are these issues that you've been able to look into? Because there have been those kind of concerns. Single currency as well is something was in the works. Can you update us on those two?
Yes, the central banks of actually the five countries are really working on the implementation of the Monetary Union Protocol, which was signed successfully last year. They're working towards a single currency. Obviously, that protocol was signed and it was given a timeline of 10 years to be implemented. So it's not something that you sign the protocol today and tomorrow, you know, we have a single currency. Mm-hmm. So it's like all the other protocols that have been signed, you know, it takes, you know, it's given a good timeline for it to, you know, again to be implemented, to be discussed, because there are a lot of challenges in between, in terms of implementation. Signing is one thing, but implementing is the other one. So the ultimate goal is one single currency, you know, but there's enough time for that to happen.
For that, so it's going to happen. Yeah. So coming from that, so far, the conversation around just some of the agreements, some of the things you're working on in the East African community, there are those who would argue, why then not just have the East African community as Kenya, Uganda, Rwanda, and have Burundi, Tanzania out? Because it appears you are reading from the same script, and these two are really not ready, maybe to use some of, in terms of getting on board onto most of these things you're working on. Would it be a fair assessment for someone who'd argue, you know what, from the face of it, these three, let them go ahead, these two, either unwilling or being isolated?
No, I think there was wisdom in the five countries, you know, the presidents of the five countries at that time when they, you know, they made the decision to be part of one community, to join it. And I think we have to respect that. Mm. As to, you know, the implementation of certain protocols, you know, that we're not moving at the same pace, I think there was also wisdom in terms of, you know, the provision within the treaty, mm-hmm. that is allowed.
Yes.
And I think we should not raise too much concern. For example, you know, I was very impressed with, you know, the discussions at the Central Corridor meeting that was held in Dar es Salaam, you know, over 2 months ago. And, you know, it was quite impressive, you know, to see, you know, the engagements that they were having, the number of, you know, investors that are interested in investing in that corridor. Mm-hmm. And we cheer them up. You know, it's part of the bigger vision.
Right.
Of the East African community. So we will arrive there. How we arrive, I think, let's not worry too much about it.
Let's not worry too much about it. Okay, yeah. I want to get also to some of the questions that have been sent in this morning. Remember, maybe we can have our phone lines on the screen and our viewers can call in. Cabinet Secretary, East African Affairs, Commerce, as well as Tourism, with us in studio this morning as our person of interest. Let me ask Kelvin Mongombe is asking about work permits, that there seems to be a drag on them, and sometimes renewable issues, getting a work permit renewed from an East African country. What can you comment on that?
Yeah, like I say, you know, that's a common market protocol.
Yes.
They the implementation is the more difficult part of these protocols, you know, and so again we engage continuously, you know, with our partner states on a bilateral basis to try to resolve some of these issues, and so there are various levels as to how this is being implemented. In our partner states, there are challenges, and when they arise, we sit down and discuss. As I've just said, we're just about to have a bilateral with Tanzania on, yes. And one of these the issues perhaps would be that, as I just said, we're going to discuss quite a number of non-tariff barriers. So we, you know, if people can't move freely, really, that's a barrier already. Mm-hmm. So unless I know the specific issue with which partner states, let me just assure him that, you know, we engage on a continuous basis. Perhaps they can alert us, the Department of East African Affairs, as to which country they're having challenges, and we'll continuously engage, you know, to try to streamline some of these issues.
James Odanya is saying the CSR talked about park entrance fees, but that appears not to have been reviewed. Is she aware that that has been implemented or not?
As far as I'm aware, it has been implemented. Mm-hmm. What we tried to do was, you know, to try to bring it to the level of, you know, the Tanzanian parks.
Okay.
Because that was a major complaint, and I think that has likely been done. What I know is there's a call for further reduction, and we're engaging, you know, KWS on that, or the Minister of Environment, on that, to see whether that's feasible.
Okay.
But I think we did bring down the fees.
The fees. Yes. Kelvin Mongombe is asking, would the CS clarify on status quo when we say Tanzania, Kenya, and we talked about that earlier, what it actually means? Is it now a Tanzanian tour vans, do they now have access to our airports? He's asking.
Yes, I think let me clarify this. When we say status quo, it meant that yes, Tanzanian vans could still access our airports, and also Kenya Airways could, you remember they could have the number of landings in Tanzania back to what it was. So back to status quo, as we, you know, prepare to sit down.
Before.
Yeah.
Okay. Then the Swahili Box Research is asking, what is the government doing about dilapidated buildings in Mombasa Old Town and as far as tourism? Because there's been that issue that some of these buildings getting more and more dilapidated. So in terms of still maintaining the face of Mombasa, the beauty of it, although on the other side, someone would argue, leave it as old as gold.
Yes.
But what are your thoughts?
Yes. I think we all need to appreciate that also tourism is devolved. When it comes to decisions like those, which I think in my view it's really a county decision, we try not to intervene as a ministry. And so perhaps that's a question that would be best answered by the county of Mombasa.
But are you engaging them as far as the implication then it has on your ministry?
Yes, we do. We engage the counties. We have a plan and a continuous engagement with the counties. You just saw me. I went around to the Western Circuit and I continuously engage the counties to see how we can support them in trying to position their product within counties. Because it's if we get it right, it's a major job employer.
Yeah, because actually that's a good area to just get your thoughts further in as far as now we have devolved counties, we have the county governments, in as far as propping them up so that they can individually even just sell, come out and be able to do this huge, whether it's presentation, whether it's push for their own counties in terms of having offices from your ministry in counties to engage more directly, because you visit, but there's only so many visits you as a CS can do to these areas.
Really, our role as national government is we're left with you know, policy decisions or policy direction. Our role is regulation, standardization, for example, like, you know, the hotel standardization. We actually build capacity of the counties mm-hmm. to manage these products, to position this product, to market these products. So we give them that support. And so you're right, when we go down to the counties, in fact, we just finished an exercise where we've been supported by the World Bank to map out tourist products within each county. So that each county would then be aware of what products they have, and if they can go a step further, then they'll be able to brand that county and market that county based on those products and position that county. And so these are the sort of support that we give them. Mm-hmm. We try to support them in terms of capacity building, training their officers yes. at the county level, and when we go abroad to market the country, we also, you know, market these unique products within those counties. Yes.
Okay, Kelvin is saying yes, he's dragging its feet on Burundi issue. Are they taking sides? A concern there, and as far as I guess we did discuss that earlier. Please ask yes how her ministry is working with industry players to promote local tourism given the current challenge. So domestic
yes.
Tourism, getting Kenyans to visit more of these places so they're not just for the foreigners. Yeah,
that is a big program that we are about to roll out. Mm-hmm. Domestic tourism for us is huge. In fact, the statistics that we have is that the past quarter, the local tourism has really helped in terms of ensuring that we sustain the tourism sector.
Yes.
On average, about 40% is being taken up by domestic tourism. And I think that figure can go up to 50%. That is our target. And so you'll be seeing programs being rolled out on domestic tourism, very interesting ones that we intend to roll out. We've already started that engagement in the social media and so forth, and we'll continue to do that.
Okay, let's get also to the Obama visit before I continue with some of your tweets, which we appreciate. Thank you so much for sending them in. Obama coming, and it's a huge one. I remember the president of the Diaspora Conference was also saying, yes, with all of these other challenges we may be facing the travel advisories, you have a huge endorsement coming with the visit of the President of the United States of America. How are you planning to capitalize on this? And for you, what does this mean for even tourism?
For us, this is huge. You know, like you say, it's a huge endorsement on Kenya. Remember, even after the unfortunate incident of Garissa, White House did make a statement to say, yes, they are coming, just to confirm that they are coming. So for us, this is a huge endorsement for this country. We are preparing, yes, as government, just to assure the Kenyan citizens that we are preparing, and we will be rolling out that program in terms of, trying to leverage on this visit mm-hmm. As government for tourism. This is exciting and it's huge for us.
Yeah.
We will. There are programs that we are preparing in terms of a PR campaign that we're about to roll out, and we'll continue pick up momentum even after the Obama visit.
So there are plans in place to yes. ensure you capitalize on this. Okay, yes. We have a call online, Eric. Understand from Member Cassie. Eric, thanks for calling. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for calling. Go ahead with your comment or question.
Oh, yes. Thank you, Anuna, for actually inviting the Minister for Tourism, the CS. And I actually have a question to the Madam CS.
Okay.
Yes. Is she actually aware that since she took over the Minister of Tourism, Kazi kaenda chini kabisa?
Let's have some more volume in studio. Sorry, please repeat the question.
I couldn't hear it.
Yeah. And then... Please
repeat the question, Eric. Let's have more volume, please.
Sorry?
Please repeat the question, that since she came into the Ministry of Tourism, what happened?
And then Kazi kind of chini kabisa.
Kazi.
It's not like, yes, it's not like when actually Balala was there.
Okay.
And then again, could she actually please make it clear about the Tanzanian vehicles coming to Kenya? She said that the vehicles can be allowed to go to our airport, But are they allowed to go to our national parks?
Okay, are they allowed to go to the parks? Eric, thank you for calling. So
what was the first question?
Kazi zimeenda. Kutoka ukuje, he says, kazi zimeenda chini. That's exactly what he said. The jobs...
the tourism sector.
The tourism sector.
Yes. His name is Eric, yeah?
Eric, yes.
Yeah, Eric, you know... I think we must appreciate, you know, the challenge that, you know, this country faced, you know, after Westgate. Mm-hmm. And I've just, as I put it, the tourism sector is really sensitive.
Correct.
In fact, it's the most sensitive sector because if you're in manufacturing, for example, you'll still produce your pencils or you still produce your juice, you know, but... And as far as tourism is concerned, a tourist will make a decision as to seek for alternative, destination to go. Mm-hmm. So that's why it's very sensitive. You know, you could be having a booming business, but if you get a challenge like that, then it's easy for it to be affected. And I think we must appreciate this.
Right.
That yes, that has happened, but as government, we are dealing with it. We are. You know, doing everything possible to support, you know, the private sector, and so generally, you know, this is a challenge that was not there before. Mm. So and it's something that is international in nature. You'll get these challenges in Paris. This challenge you'll find it in London. Mm-hmm. Australia the other day did announce that they just stopped a 17-year-old from actually carrying out an attack. Yeah. And so I think we need to appreciate that. Yes, Kenya is not the only country that is facing this challenge. Mm. But as government, yes, we're working with our international partners in terms of exchanging information and working and dealing with this really new challenge.
And I guess for Erica and for many in the industry especially, their concern is given what you're saying, it's granted, it's a challenge, and there's not sometimes much that can be done in as far as it is there. It's just counter-terrorism measures, you know, to work hard to ensure the same are in place. But that your ministry especially does enough and is seen to do enough to cushion the industry, that whilst on one hand this is happening, that you work to ensure that they do not necessarily then have to suffer all of these consequences, that there are measures pre-thought, pre-planned, set in and put in place, so in the event of this happening, then doesn't mean the entire industry collapses.
I think let's put it in perspective. The cost is, yes, suffering, and I've stated that before. That is where the hotels have closed at the cost. Mm-hmm. Mainly because if you looked at the travel advisories, especially coming from the UK, it was very specific to the cost. And I think they've even said it includes the airport. So it has really affected the cost, and that's where the hotels have closed.
Okay.
I've just told you that the safari product is doing very well, and in fact, we're looking at the numbers going up in terms of, the safari product.
Okay.
We have, as a ministry, we have diversifying the product. We're looking at conference tourism, for example. Mm-hmm. That's an area that the government is investing in. We are positioning this country as the best business conference destination in Africa. We, with government support, we are building the biggest international conference and exhibition center at the Bomas of Kenya, 82 acres where we will put one of the biggest conference facilities. Okay. We are improving all the other facilities, even at KSCC, in terms of conferencing. We trying to promote conference tourism. We have huge conferences coming in over the next until December. Mm. We have the enterprise conference that Obama himself is coming to visit, to be part of in July.
Okay.
We have other conferences, the peak of which will be in December. We have the WTO conference.
Yes, WTO is happening.
And so government is not sitting back.
the measures being put
really
in place?
Going out of our way. Okay. If we bring all these conferences coming in, that is for us, will support at the end of the day
the
to
industry.
Support the tourism sector.
Okay.
So we're doing a lot as government, right. And I want to reassure the tourist sector. I know there's a lot of job losses. As government, we're not happy to see job losses, you know. But
you're
we're
saying
not
things will
back.
Change.
Yes, things
okay.
will change.
Let's finally take two more calls before we wrap up. Amos is on the line. Amos, good morning.
Good morning.
Go ahead.
How are you?
Hi.
I'm calling from South Coast.
Okay.
Kunda specifically.
Right.
My question is, with the ministry at the moment having the East Africa, the tourism, is it too much for her, with the issue that we are hearing in the near future that the ministry could be divided and maybe a separate ministry of tourism?
All right, Amos, thank you.
How can she say about it?
All right, we'll put that to her. Thank you. We also have another caller online, Kevin. Hello? Do we still have Mr. Kevin? Okay, we've lost Sir Kevin. Yeah, but Amos, so this is not as was before, so it's a bigger ministry. You have more mandate, a lot on your plate. And seeing what has been happening with tourism, he's asking, is it too much? Do we separate this and say, let's focus on little bits and pieces?
You know, let me put my responsibility into perspective.
Right.
You know, at the end of the day, my ministry is the marketing arm of government. Our role is to position Kenya out there. Our role is to deepen and widen the markets for the private sector.
Right.
Because it's an entirely private sector, implementation. I mean, the private sector implements the policies that we develop. Mm-hmm. And our policies is geared towards, you know, deepening and widening the markets for Kenyans or for the private sector. So even if you look at tourism is still, at the end of the day, if you look at the issues, it's a trade issue. They are trade issues. They're commerce issues.
Commerce, yeah.
Yes.
ESC?
If you look at ESC, is a market. Basically, at the end of the day, and
a
the issues
market,
that we deal
with more diverse issues. It's, well, a market is one of the.
But
elements.
If you look at the issues that we discuss at the ESC, largely they're trade issues.
Okay.
They're trade issues at the end of the day,
mm.
And so you need to link up with the domestic, you know, policy decisions for you to push the agenda at the regional level.
So it's not too much. You don't feel it's too heavy.
It's how you get organized. You know, in government, you have three departments that do various things.
Okay.
You have tourism, you have trade, and you have East African Affairs that does actually the coordination of not only the other departments but also the rest of government.
Okay.
So at the end of the day, if you look at it from that perspective,
that there's a common thread.
There's
that
a
connects.
Common thread.
All right.
And you need. In fact, you have a better advantage as minister of trade at the regional level. To engage your colleagues than if you're just minister of one
okay.
ESC,
all right.
For example.
We have Kevin back online. Let's listen to his question. Kevin, good morning.
Morning.
Thank you for calling. Go ahead.
Hello.
Yes, we hear you.
My name is Kevin.
Mm-hmm.
Calling from Bugiri.
Right.
I want to ask the CS.
Mm-hmm.
Money.
Can you have more volume? Yes, go ahead, Kevin. Yes, we can hear you. Just ask the question.
Okay, I want to ask the question.
Mm-hmm.
Remember the community voted for campaigns against the Western Front.
Okay, Kevin, we need you to just ask your question, although the line is really terrible. Yes. President Kenyatta? Okay, Kevin, I'm sorry, we'll have you try call back. At the moment, we cannot make out what you're saying, but let's attempt to perhaps speak to Samuel. Samuel, good morning. Samuel?
Hello?
Hi. Okay. Hi.
Hi.
Thanks for calling. We're listening to you. Go ahead.
Yeah, good morning. My name is Samuel.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm calling from Kuru.
Right.
Hi. Hello?
We hear you, Samuel. Please get to your question.
Yeah, mine is not a question.
Okay.
But just a compliment of what the ministry is doing.
Okay.
Yeah, I really appreciate what Madam Kandi is doing. Mm. Especially to do with her. Yeah, I wanted to find out what the plan, especially for the people who've lost their jobs. Almost 40,000 people, I think the statistics were like 23,000, I think, and they were paying 40,000 by April. Mm-hmm. And 23 hotels have already been completely closed. You know, tourism, to us, tourism is the second largest earner after the culture. That is in Kenya.
Okay.
And in Kunda, we understand in Kenya is like third best beach in the world after one in Fishers and the other in South Africa. So the tourists come specifically just for leisure, not for business. A very small percentage comes for business, but a very large percentage comes for luxury. And it's mostly at the coast. That's where we have tourism. Despite the fact that there have been travel advice and all that,
okay.
I understand the madam is really what we have.
All right, Samuel. All right, thank you very much. We have to end it there. Our time is running out, Samuel. Thank you. Thank you for calling. And he says you're doing a great job.
Thank you.
Yeah, he says you're doing a great job at the ministry. Of course, he'd gone ahead to ask a question, although he said he will not ask about the jobs being lost, but we did address that earlier on, so we will not repeat that. But as we bring this to a close, there was a plan to reclassify hotels, mm-hmm. to rate them in mm-hmm. terms of whether it's 2-star, 3-star, 5-star. Mm-hmm. Where are we at in terms of that?
Yes. When I came into office, I set up within the ministry a unit that would eventually be the Tourism Regulatory Authority as per the Tourism Act. And so that unit is already up and running. We're just waiting for the board so that it now becomes an entirely new parastatal.
Yeah.
It's working very well. We have trained people that will classify these hotels and ensure that they rate the hotels. Mm-hmm. We have actually focused on Western Kenya. And as I speak, they're in that part of Kenya.
And this routing helps with?
Standardization of hotels, that's
okay.
number one.
Okay.
It helps us in terms of a destination because, we're doing it as an East African community activity. Mm-hmm. So meaning that our trainers were trained at the ESC level. By the ESC Secretariat, so I could get a Tanzanian to come and rate an hotel in Kenya, mm. or vice versa, because okay. you remember it was controversial initially
right.
when it was done. So right now we are doing it as ESC, and so each country is doing their part,
mm.
and so this will help us as a destination because it means right now you wouldn't know apart from the big hotels, people just wake up one morning and say my hotel is 3-star and you don't really know. Nobody ever rated them. So we want to bring this standardization to an international level.
Yeah, it also gets them to work hard on their product.
Exactly. They can upgrade their product.
Yeah.
These are the issues, the challenges that we face as a tourism sector.
Okay.
And I think it's something that the whole sector is looking forward to.
So we've canvassed quite a lot of issues. We need to let you go. I understand you have a busy morning.
Mm-hmm.
But the French tour operators yesterday, I read
yes.
in the newspapers, are
yes.
giving Kenya a clean bill of health.
Yes.
So your parting shot as we let you go this morning?
I think, again, let me talk about the negative, stories, negative perception that people have out there about Kenya. No, because Kenya is what the world has painted Kenya to be.
Mm-hmm.
It's each one of us, how we, you know, how do we contribute to change that negative perception? I think for me, if we can all take that responsibility, Kenya will be the better.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
We wish you the very best.
Thank you.
Phyllis Kandie, she's the Cabinet Secretary, East African Affairs, Commerce and Tourism, with us this morning, and she says you and I have a role to play in building, ensuring that Kenya image works out for us, our economy, and our neighbors as well, as we are in East African community. So stay with Morning Express. That's why we wrap up Person of Interest this morning. Michael Gitonga is standing by. Cholera has robbed us of quite a number of lives in the past few days. He'll be sharing with you the stats, where we stand as a country and why you should be concerned and what you need to know as you go by your life to ensure that this does not affect you or your loved ones, measures you need to put in place to protect yourself. So cholera is on your health segment in just a few minutes. Stay with us.